Cooey. Yeah, I'm talking to you. Yeah, I'm back. You're a failure. You're useless. You're stupid. Your life's not worth living and you know it. So do exactly what I say. Go and get a knife and slash your wrists. In fact, before you do that, I've got another little plan for you. Kill somebody else. Go out in style. Go on, you could do it. You'll get some relief from this useless life you're living. Go on, do it. That's what it's like to hear voices. Not nice, eh?
Dr. Rufus May thinks hearing voices can be a good thing. He's a maverick psychologist, and last week, Ruth Fielding came to see him for the first time. Ruth's a junior doctor who's hearing a voice telling her to kill herself. Most doctors would say Ruth is a danger to herself and others and have her sectioned. Rufus is different. He doesn't think there's anything wrong with madness.
Give me a bit of space, Liam.
Rufus May is one of the most controversial doctors working in the NHS today. He thinks there's no such thing as schizophrenia, that medication can destroy lives, and that all mental hospitals should be shut down. He says we should learn to love mad people. He does. He was mad himself once.
How many voices are you hearing?
One.
Is it male or female? Look at me, Ruth. Is it male or female?
Male.
What kind of things is it saying? What's it saying, Ruth?
Telling me to kill myself and ways to do it.
Well, you don't have to do what it says. You've got a choice. Yeah.
I can't be a doctor and hear voices.
This is a true story filmed over 12 months. To protect Ruth's identity, all her scenes have been reenacted using an actor. And some details have been changed. Everything else is the original documentary footage, filmed as it happened. This is the hospital where Ruth used to work. Four weeks ago, she told her employer she was suffering from depression and feeling suicidal. They immediately suspended her, saying there was no way she could work as a doctor in this condition. If she had told them she was hearing voices, they would have sacked her and have her sectioned. Rufus has taken her swimming. He's got a different way of helping people with their mental health problems. He's slowly building up her trust. He's been working with Ruth unofficially for 2 weeks now, outside his NHS work.
Need a bit more training, Rufus.
All right, I reckon the third time. I'll be lucky.
Thank you.
Rufus thinks Ruth should be allowed to be a doctor. He wants to help her get back in. They've agreed to keep the fact that she's hearing a voice and not taking her medication a secret.
What do you think of Rufus?
I trust him, I think. And, I can't really go with my problems to my work, so I feel like he's my only choice at the moment.
Rufus told me this was a vulnerable time for Ruth. Her voice is easily triggered. I should have listened to him. Instead, I asked her to talk about feeling suicidal.
You okay? What's happening? Tell me what's going on.
No, it's all right. What happens?
You're hearing a voice now.
No, right, I told them about, God, right, can I just... I'm gonna get outside, is that right?
Sure.
For the medical authorities, Ruth not taking medication represents a danger to herself and the public. Rufus will work with people on medication, but when Ruth said she'd stop taking her medication, he told her it was a good thing to do.
Here's a woman coming to you in crisis.
Yeah.
You're working with her, and you think it's better that she's not using medication, better for her recovery. Would some professional think that's you're being very unprofessional? And
I think it's worth a try. I think it's worth a try. It's not definitely going to be better for her. But she could give it her best shot.
But the point is, you are not encouraging her to take medication. You are not encouraging her to seek.
That's just dampening everything down. But you're just repressing the experiences. They're going to come bouncing back.
Over 14,000 people are currently held in psychiatric hospitals like this one where Rufus works. On average, there are 50 murders committed by people with mental health problems every year in Britain. A number of these people were not taking medication at the time. 1,200 people with mental health problems kill themselves each year. Many of these hear voices.
Hello. Yeah, I've come to see Jane.
She's just in this room and you don't want to go through.
Oh, great. Thanks. Hello?
Hi.
I wasn't able to film Rufus working with people under section. Rufus qualified 10 years ago and has worked with hundreds of patients. An important part of his work is running self-help groups. He's brought Ruth along to get help from other voice hearers.
My voices are aliens. I feel we're an experiment and we're being watched by aliens, and that they take us in their spaceships and do mad experiments, and my voices always tell me that they're going to come in their spaceship and do experiments and take my eyes out and burn my eyes and make me blind. Groups like this are brilliant because you don't need to hide. You could take the pretense off. For instance, if I said my voices are telling me to kill myself and my kids, if I told that to a normal person, they would be like, oh my God, put the reins in, care, get, you know, kids are in danger, whereas I'm just saying what the voices say, I'm not saying that I'm going to do it.
I thought this would be a really positive experience for Ruth. She said she found it traumatic. Her voice was yelling at her the whole time.
What did she say about the voices? Her voices were telling her to do.
Oh, her voices have been saying for about a week, telling her to kill me. I think they were saying kill him, but she assumed it was me. And now I think they've been saying kill Rufus, or her voice. She's got a voice. I said, well, that's progress. The voice is not telling you to kill yourself. It's telling you to kill other people. That's progress. No. Because the public might not think that. But, you know, she's more likely to kill herself than anyone else.
Rufus invited me to a debate about madness. This is a profession at war with itself about how to treat people like Ruth. I didn't expect Rufus to use the opportunity to launch a personal attack on one of the country's leading psychiatrists.
I've come here because of your book about schizophrenia, and I really object to what's in it.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I think that you're trying to do a good job, but you're imprisoned by your training.
I'm misguided by my training.
You're misguided by your training, and you're a victim of your training. And what these concepts do is imprison people. There's nothing in this book about how psychotic experiences are actually meaningful. And that when people come out with what you call word salad, you really listen to people's experiences, there's a meaning there. You have to decode it. Trevor, it is really, you know, you're a clever man. You know, it's well written. But there's a lot missing, the meaning. The recovery's not in the index.
In the context of recovery, as you mentioned, and ways of helping people with schizophrenia, I've always regarded...
Diagnosis of schizophrenia.
The people
labels.
Suffering
from... Labels.
Well, yeah, that's a 20-year debate, isn't it? In terms of trying to understand...
No, I've been labelled, I know what it's like. Well, half your patients won't thank you for that diagnosis, and you know that.
Well, no, that's... Well, I don't know that.
Well, you're not listening to them, then.
Of course I'm not listening to them. Of course, silly me. Yeah. I don't listen to my patients. How do you know that, Rufus? How do you know that?
Because by reading your book.
Let me finish your book.
Yeah,
exactly. So therefore, have you ever sat with me?
Because you're not telling people's stories.
Have you ever sat with me and a patient? Have you asked my patients personally?
Well, yes.
Have you just
you were,
no.
you were
have
you sat in you're a doctor with me, and you didn't challenge my diagnosis.
Have you sat in my clinic?
Yes.
When?
About 20 years ago.
When Rufus was 18, he went mad. He was diagnosed with acute schizophrenia, told he would never recover and have to take medication for the rest of his life. He was detained in an intimidating ward in a psychiatric hospital in East London.
And I had this laugh, you know, to make me seem scarier than the other patients, you know, because there were serious people there, you know, people who'd been in Brilmore prison, you know, and I was 18, looked about 15, you know. So I developed this laugh, it's like, I don't do that very often, because once you start doing it, you can't stop doing it. But then it became quite addictive to do, you know, people would be like, what's he like? I hope I haven't scared those people. It's really... God. Well, Rufus, how are you today? Yes, I know you want to leave. The nurses have told me this. Just wondering how your thoughts are at the moment. Do you still think you're a spy? You just feel on one side of this chasm, you're mentally ill, they're not. You feel that kind of leper role. You know, these people are never going to invite you home for dinner. You know, these people think you're genetically different to them. You know, degenerate. Fucked.
Rufus is pissed off at me. He thinks my questions provoke Ruth's voice to start attacking her. When he spoke to her this morning, she was manic and raging. He arranged to meet her urgently.
If you're angry, you know, don't take it out on the lamppost, take it out on me, you know. Hit me. No, not really.
You want me to hit you? You want me to hit you?
Well, let's
A spark.
Don't hit you.
Pretend. Come on. Go on. Okay. All right. Okay, take it easy.
Stop. Keep your head down. Just... Look, watch, you're not there.
Hey! Oh, that's really excellent.
Ruth was diagnosed with bipolar disorder a few years ago and told she would need medication for the rest of her life. Rufus has been working with her for 2 months now without medication. He seems strangely encouraged by her manic behaviour. He said there's something to be learned from it. He's just not sure what it is.
We had these like messages from, like, there's a wolf in the moon, and if I look at the moon, right, you see a wolf in it, and it's like an old myth thing. The wolf used to sing this song that was really beautiful and really healing for the whole of its pack, but they never really appreciated it. And then he was on his death, like he was walking to his death, and he walked to the moon towards his death.
Hold on, Ruth. Myths are symbolic.
No, but it's...
Hold on, listen to me. Myths are symbolic and death is a new beginning. This time out, meeting me, finding out new ways to see your problems, this is a new beginning. You can recover. Before, you never thought you could recover. You thought you'd be a, you know, trendy doctor with a bipolar disorder. Now you found out you can actually recover. You know, we can't afford it. We can't afford to lose you, Ruth. There's too many good people been lost. We don't need another one going. This just will help with the voice and with all that bombardment you were getting earlier on. You know, your senses were being bombarded. Just concentrate on your breathing. Concentrate on how the tree feels. Just count your breathing. So as you're breathing in one, in your mind, breathing in one, breathing out one.
Trevor Turner has been working as a consultant psychiatrist for almost 20 years. I asked him how he would treat someone in Ruth's condition.
Most patients who have severe psychiatric symptoms that schizophrenics have, such as hearing voices or delusional beliefs or thinking your thoughts are being read, do respond to antipsychotic medication. It makes them better. It calms them down. It damps down the voices, sometimes eliminates the voices. It makes them to think more clearly, and it makes them feel less aroused and anxious. And over the course of 2 or 3 weeks, 3 or 4 weeks, miracles occur.
You give someone a tablet, it shuts them up. It makes them dumb and stupid. People then have the ignorance to think the medication is making someone better. You're not making someone better, making them stupid. There's a big myth being promoted here that drugs are the answer. And the prescribers know it most of the time.
If you had persisting symptoms of a schizophrenic illness, didn't take medication, and tried to carry on, you would, from the studies we know that are pre-war, develop an impairment in your intellectual functioning. That's what we know about the illness.
You would get worse.
You would get worse. Well, you would certainly get worse, yes.
To keep busy, Ruth's got a part-time job in an old people's home. But she's starting to have some disturbing ideas about a fish tank in the day room. Rufus has been working with her for 3 months now, and he believes her delusions are normal. I'm starting to worry about both of them.
I work in the day room, there's a fish tank. And the bubbles come from the bottom, and they produce an ECG trace on it.
ECG?
You know, like a heart monitor, you know, monitors the heart rate and demonstrates the sort of electrical activity going on in the heart. Right. Yeah, maybe that was my purpose at my place of work. I was there to interpret these bubbles and what it meant, and trying to work out which resident it was, like whether it was the one sitting nearest to it. That's why I'd be watching each resident, and every time one of them got slightly agitated, I'd look to see if the heart rate went up. And, you know, so by process of elimination, working out which resident it was.
Are you concerned about her ability to be a doctor?
No. 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 She's only ever been a risk to herself, not other people.
But when you said she felt she had the cure for AIDS.
Yeah. That's okay. I'm trying to help people. Maybe she's getting close to the cure for AIDS.
That's flippant. This is a serious matter.
Tell me how that could harm people.
Okay, when she thinks that the fish tank is controlling someone's heartbeat.
Yeah. Yeah, but she's in therapy. She's with me. We're working through some stuff. This is her. This is an identity struggle she's got to go through. She's going to have some weird experiences.
The next time I see Ruth, these weird experiences seem to have taken over. She's convinced that people are trying to poison her food. And she's now openly arguing with her voice. Despite all this, Ruth has never lost her determination to get back to being a doctor. To accept her back, Ruth's employers need to be convinced she's fully recovered and taken her medication. They've asked her to attend a series of assessment interviews.
You may hate them, but tomorrow you've got to be nice to them. This is the difficult stuff, you know, but she's misleading the authorities.
Well, no, that's completely the open. I mean, you're promoting that.
Yeah. I'm supporting that.
It's tricky. Are you nervous about that? It's tricky. Why? Because you could lose your job. Could you lose your job?
No, I don't know. People might try and get me struck off the British Psychological Society Association, but I'm not a member. They've tried that. Hello, Ruth. How are you?
Yeah, I'm fine. I'm fine, actually. Really good.
Good. I'm glad to hear things are going well. Really am.
Yeah.
So how are your moods in general?
My moods are fine. They're stabilised. And I had that low patch just before I was asked to leave. But I've been really good moods recently, and I'm stabilised on the drugs.
I'm supporting her in what she needs to do to get on with her career. There's been times when I haven't been totally honest about my past. You know?
Well, you've
and that's
to,
paid.
You've had to lie about your...
I've had to lie about my history.
Yeah.
And there's not much difference. She's got to lie about her experiences.
Rufus had to cover up his own diagnosis of schizophrenia to be allowed to train as a psychologist. It was only after he qualified he came out about his history in a bid to challenge the stigma.
The diagnosis of any mental illness is stigmatizing. Absolutely. Doesn't matter whether it's depression.
What I'm talking about.
It's not schizophrenia.
Doesn't matter if it's depression.
Doesn't matter if it's depression, schizophrenia, manic depressive psychosis, obsession. If you've got a psychiatric diagnosis, the occupational health will be jumping down your throat in seconds, saying, are you sure? If you apply for a job, doesn't matter where, and say you've had a mental illness of any sort, how many employers have put you down for possible interviewing? You ask any of the patients, they say no, they shut up about it. We tell them to shut up about it.
You do shut up?
Yeah. We tell them, we have to, because of the nature of stigma.
So hang on, you tell people to lie about their diagnosis on their application forms for work?
I tell people, I don't tell people to lie. I say to people, it's probably best not to mention that you've had any kind of mental illness or any sort. They, and they know, I don't have to tell that. They'll tell
sure,
me.
Sure, but if the form says, do you have mental illness?
Yeah. What would you put?
I would put no.
Yes, so would I.
While Ruth was having her assessment interview, I waited outside. She asked me to stay in the car and keep a low profile.
How'd it go?
All right. It was really funny. Well, no, it wasn't funny. It was really hard because I had to practice what I was going to say. And then, like, towards the end of the interview, the voice comes in and he's like, they're going to find you out. They're going to find you a fraud. They're going to get to you. So I had to, like, tie my shoelaces to strap myself. You look at the floor, I was absolutely shitting it. Just...
What did you do? Tell me what happened?
Went in, asked how he was. Open shoulders, good eye contact. Yes, I'm fine, thank you. How about yourself? It just sort of means you're interested in the wider world. You're not just obsessed with what's going on in your own world. You know, puts on the back foot a bit. And I was so aware of what I was doing was completely, I don't know, it just felt dishonest and felt like your integrity is ripping apart.
Ruth got through the interview without arousing suspicion, but she was told she'd be closely monitored for the next 6 months.
That was yours.
Thank you.
Last week, Ruth discovered the fish tank at her work wasn't actually controlling someone's heart. I thought it'd be okay to ask her about it.
Isn't this part of the journey, part of the experience?
What do you mean?
I mean, I don't know if this is right or wrong, but is it not part of... I mean, you're having this experience is... I mean, I don't know what I mean.
No, I don't know. Part of the journey. What
does that sound like? Does it sound like... Is it not part of a journey?
No, exactly. That. In some ways, it still is. It's real. That was controlling a person. And, like, then actually it's not... But when you truly believe it is, and like you had a responsibility, that was my purpose for being there, and...
This mad idea that a fish tank is an ECG machine is a deeply symbolic image that actually holds the clue to her healing. What does ECG measure?
Your heartbeat.
What did her... We can't talk about this, but what did she die of? A heart attack?
That's my brother. He died when I was 15. He was 14. He had a heart problem. His heart stopped. Playing football one day and he dropped dead. My best friend.
Rufus wants Ruth to write a letter to her dead brother. This sends Ruth's voice into a rage, pushing her deeper into madness than I've ever seen her.
Should I come in with you?
No. Wait here. I'll see if you're invited.
Rufus believes that Ruth has deep, unresolved emotions connected to her brother's death. He's asked her to write a letter to her brother to help unlock those feelings.
Ruth!
Ruth's voice is now constantly harassing her, telling her not to do it. It's screaming at her, claiming Rufus is conspiring with her employers to destroy her. She hasn't slept for days.
Hi.
I can't see you today, okay? It's not safe. I'm being watched.
What's going on?
I'm being watched. There's a moped. I've seen it. The same one 3 times today. It's not safe.
Well, the best thing is, if we talk about it, check it out. And if I come in, we can talk about it and see, you know,
just
what's
check.
Going on. I will check. Yeah.
Rufus uses a radical dialogue technique to talk directly to people's voices. Many psychiatrists think this is irresponsible and dangerous. Rufus thinks he can find clues to unlock the identity of Ruth's voice.
Oh, thanks for agreeing to do this. It's a really good idea. Ruth?
Yeah.
So what it is if you sit here, then I can, you act as a spokesperson for the voice, just tell me what he's saying. Actually, might be better if we do it here, a bit further away. So, Leo, if you can move,
yeah, sure,
please.
Sorry.
And I'm gonna take notes just so that we can feedback and discuss it, and then you can have the notes. So, thanks very much for agreeing to talk to us. And how long have you been in Ruth's life?
I've always been here.
Because Ruth says that you've only been around for a couple of months.
She's only just started listening.
What's your role in Ruth's life?
I'm here to make her kill herself. And I won't leave until she does.
And why should she kill herself?
Because she's weak. She's alone. She's a worthless piece of shit.
Well, I don't think she is alone. I mean, I think it suits you to try and isolate her, but she's not alone. She's coming to conferences, she's meeting with me regularly, she's really reading up about hearing voices and how to cope with it, determined to get back into work.
She's pretending to listen to you.
Okay. So you're like a critic, are you?
I'm like a prophecy.
Well, we will resist that prophecy.
I'll fight you. You're a fucking do-gooder. You're not helping anyone.
I think it'd be really good if you could stop misleading her about how people are following her and plotting against her, because that's just not true.
It's fun.
Rufus thinks Ruth's voice might represent her fear of opening up to people, and that this is stopping her from writing the letter to her brother.
She was in quite a bad space. Maybe. I've got to rethink. This conspiracy theory is quite strong. This paranoia she's got is quite strong at the moment. Like replace the kind of the goldfish bowl idea. It's now more an idea that she's under surveillance and some people are plotting her death and stuff. Her demise.
Hi.
Hi.
Come in.
Hi.
Is this Nutmeg?
Rufus has been working with Ruth for 5 months He's invited her to his home for the weekend. By taking her out of her environment, he wants to see if he can break the hold that the voice has over her.
Go, you're not even looking for it. Go upstairs, please.
She had waited outside his house for hours before knocking, checking cars and passers-by. Her voice had told her this was an attempt to kidnap and section her.
Ruth?
Yeah?
We'll go out the back.
Right, OK, yeah.
What do you mean I've got knives in my pockets?
He told me you've got knives in your pockets. He's telling me you're trying to kill me. Can I see your pockets,
please? Well, he would say that. I really care about you. I wouldn't try and harm you. You're pushing people away. You're still doing it. You've been doing it for years. You've got to let people in.
I met Ruth after the weekend she spent with Rufus. She managed to finish the letter he wanted her to write to her brother.
Dear Carl, I was told to write you a letter. I'm not sure what to write because I know you'll never read this. Right now, your body's about 4 foot under the ground in a coffin. Has been for the last 6 years. Your body will have begun to decompose and your tissues will degrade and there's no life in your body at all. Just nutrients for small creatures to benefit from. As soon as you went, I tried to carry on as usual. I had this strange feeling inside me that I didn't know what it was, and whenever I tried to touch it, I felt lost and confused. So I left it alone. I think in my heart I knew you were gone, but in my head I would think that you'd gone on holiday for a while. Mum gave me the photograph of us together the day we went to Brighton. She found it in your room. That was the first day I ever cut myself. Right now, I want a big hug, and I'm deeply crying, and I need to be held tight, but my pride and stubbornness is stopping me. It's not fear. It's that it will see through my shell to how vulnerable I am, still lost. But now I have a compass. Where are you? I love you and hate you. I feel guilty. I should feel lucky that I'm alive when you died. If I start living again, does that reinforce your death, the fact that you've gone? Am I clinging on to you? It's quite futile. You're not on holiday, are you? You're not coming back.
She just seems to have come through a kind of sense of giving up on herself, and she's positive. She's still vulnerable to feeling difficult feelings about where she's at, but she's much more stable and positive. Stable's the wrong word, really.
Is the voice still there, though?
The voice is still there.
the voice is still there, and yesterday was telling her to harm her parents, I think.
Does that worry you when you hear that now, even, you know?
Well, it's meaningful. It means that she needs to work on her feelings towards her parents, so I see it as useful.
Just a week later, and Ruth seems worse, not better.
God, it's looking...
It's looking at me, I think. It's the camera.
Her final assessment interview to decide whether she can return to work is fast approaching. Worryingly, her paranoia seems to be getting stronger. She's convinced she's been followed by people in cars with her initials on their number plates. And her voice is as menacing as ever.
It's talking more about my parents now and telling me to kill them. Like, use the knife, telling me to use a knife. I was in the kitchen and there's a knife on the side and they were just...
What happens then? Does the voice disappear?
No, he stays for a bit and... Oh, sorry.
You're right, it's okay.
Yeah,
all right.
You're drawing like those attention to you.
The next day, I received a troubling email from Ruth. I tried to contact her, but she didn't return my calls. I told Rufus about it. He told me she'd gone missing. I know he's thinking she may have killed herself, but he refuses to talk about it.
I don't really understand why we can't discuss this business of...
It doesn't feel safe with the camera on.
It doesn't feel safe?
No.
Why are you so uncomfortable talking about this?
Well, you know, people go... Because you can't... Because we live in a risk-averse culture, and I should be... If I'm concerned about someone, I should be talking to the authorities. So by talking about it on camera, I'm incriminating myself.
If you came across someone,
yep,
hearing voices,
yep,
the voice telling them to kill themselves,
yep,
regularly,
yep,
telling them to kill their parents, they have a belief that they're being followed.
Yeah,
that the number plates in cars
are deliberately, yeah, a special meaning to them.
With their initials are following them.
Yes.
What would you do? How would you help that person?
Well, if I knew that person was around and the parents had come to see me about him or her, then I would try and arrange as soon as possible an urgent assessment, visit, home visit, wherever, to go and see that guy and sort out what we can do to help.
Now, if that person... So you saw that person, but if that person didn't want help,
if I considered that she did have a mental illness, that for my talking to her, I could be assured that she has symptoms typical of a mental illness, like schizophrenia, as you say, and if I considered that those symptoms put her at risk to the health and safety of other people, I would detain her under a section of the Mental Health Act. I would hack my way in through a front door, and I would detain her and bring her into hospital, if necessary. And we do this regularly.
And if she didn't want to take medication in hospital?
Then we would insist on her taking medication.
How would you do that?
We would try to persuade her and discuss with her the pros and cons, if we could communicate with her. If she was uncommunicado
and she wasn't willing to take any medication, not even a syrup of any sort, which is easy to swallow, in the end we would have to inject her under restraint by trained nurses, nurses trained in control and restraint in the most comfortable and supportive way.
Well, maybe I'd... maybe I'm, because of my own experiences, maybe I am in denial of the risks.
That's a big one. Do you think so?
I hope not. I hope I'm not just pouring my own experience into people's lives and taking huge risks.
That could be a criticism.
Yeah, I guess people might think that I've got a chip on my shoulder about not being given enough freedom, and so I give people too much freedom. So I've got to check that out. I've got to kind of trust that I've developed to being more than that, and that I'm listening to my heart rather than listening to some resentment or unquenched feeling from the past. If you have your pyjamas pulled down and you're injected in the buttocks, held down by five nurses, you know, you feel humiliated, you feel degraded, you feel upset and angry. Very angry. Nowhere to go with that anger. You want to kill the people who've done that to you. Or hurt them.
Rufus is relieved to be back in contact with Ruth after her disappearance. It's 7 months now, and Ruth is finding Rufus's methods too painful.
I phoned her up and she said she was very angry. She didn't want me. She wanted me to leave her alone. And, you know. So she was angry, and she said, don't call me again.
Yeah. What, ever again?
Mm. So are you still angry with me?
I know she's having serious doubts whether Rufus is the right way to go.
If you start crying, don't hang up on me. We can carry on talking through it. It's not weakness. Just take some deep breaths and we'll carry on. This is important. Well, no, you're doing the really important stuff. You know, you've done really well, but you've just got to reassess at the moment how you're doing it and go forth renewed. She's back on board the process. Understandably got cold feet, and she said it's easier to go into retreat. Right, upstairs, that was the deal. You get into bed and brush your teeth, okay? They were hateful, inferior forms of life. She saw a child standing up on a back seat to wave at her, and she cringed. Why had she never noticed how ugly people were? There was just no point to people. They were wasteful, always at war with each other. They were better off dead than the universe would be a tidier place.
Rufus became unusually reluctant to talk about Ruth. He said there was nothing happening, she was doing fine. I knew he was bullshitting me.
So what do you want to talk about
you
then?
Bollocks is what I want to do. You're a dark horse, aren't you?
Well, am I in trouble?
It turns out there'd been a breakthrough. They'd done some dialogue work where they discovered the identity of Ruth's voice. I clearly wasn't invited. Rufus thought it was hilarious.
What? No. What's she told you?
So, Rufus, you know all those phone calls we had over the last couple of weeks? No, she's fine. Today she's grand, no problems, everything's cool.
Yeah.
You were slightly distant with me, I thought.
Yeah. Yeah. Did any alarm bells ring for you?
Yeah, fair amount.
One of the conditions that she would do this work with me is that it wouldn't be documented. I just felt like we still didn't know who the voice represented. Before we did it, I went through all the possible people that the voice could be. Could it be the psychiatrist? Could it be her own anger at the world for taking away someone she loved? So the interview was trying to find out who it could be, and didn't tally with any of these people. It was too abusive, too negative, too just determined to achieve her destruction. I said, who has ever used this kind of language with you? You know, calling you a pile of shit. And that's when we figured out that it was this high school bully. And then she was like, oh, now I know that my voice is ugly. And she laughed about that, but, you know, now I know what he looks like. And he didn't like that. He was like, yeah. But,
Well, what? Who? The voice didn't like?
Yeah.
What, did it say something when she said that?
Yeah, yeah,
what
yeah. What did it say? I don't know, because I wasn't doing the voice dialogue at that time. But I could tell. She said, oh, nothing. He doesn't like that, being called ugly.
Why do you think the voice is the bully?
I think it's just the things the voice says and the way he says them, it sort of very much mirror the attitude and the things this guy used to say. He'd tell me that I was shit and fat and no good, never be good at anything, no one ever liked me. And he'd put me down in front of loads of people in the class as well, and he'd single me out. It's funny, when we were 17, he came up to me and he said, I'm sorry for what I did.
Really?
Yeah. Was it me that made you self-harm? And I was like, no, don't worry, it was me. He just passed it off. So, like, he did acknowledge it.
Well, that was good, no?
Yeah. But maybe if I did... I wonder if I did resolve it. Like, maybe I should have said, well, actually, you made me feel shit and worthless for 2 years and you made school pretty crappy for me. Maybe if I faced up to it more, rather than just passing it off as me.
What's the future of the voice?
Nice room to leave, ideally. It's like I've got really used to him. It'd be weird when he goes. And just, I mean, that, like, there's been times when he hasn't spoken to me for like 3 days, something like that, and it's you're really aware of it, and you're like, has he gone? Has he gone? It's kind of not sadness, but you just get used to having someone around, you know what I mean? Like, some of the stuff he says, some of the passive comments he makes about people can be quite funny.
Well, the voice can make you laugh.
Yeah, just like taking the piss out of other people and...
Give me an example.
Well, he doesn't like you, and doesn't like Rufus very much. That can be fun sometimes.
Does he not like the film?
He hasn't commented on the film. I don't know. Start with provoking us.
Tomorrow, Ruth faces her final assessment panel, which includes a consultant psychiatrist. They will decide whether she's fit to practice as a doctor. If they get even a whiff of the truth, her career is over. Rufus has convinced Ruth her panel don't want to know that she's hearing a voice. I think he's still trying to convince himself.
Tell them what they want to hear.
Yeah, but they...
When people say, how are you, they don't really want to know
that
you haven't slept. It's just it's a variation on that. That's how I'm putting it to her.
But
they don't want to know about voice hearing. They can't handle that information. They don't want to know about... But apart from that, she's doing really well anyway. So I'm, you know, I don't feel like we're telling them this big lie. She has made a really good recovery.
Yeah.
So,
but when they ask,
we can't tell them the details of that because of their own prejudices. So we're protecting them from that. You know.
What? That's good spin. Yeah, but you don't really believe that. I mean, that she has not been taking her medication. She has delusional beliefs. She's hearing voices. She's persecutory voices telling her to do destructive things. Do you think they genuinely don't want to know that?
Not if it's not affecting her ability to practice. I don't think they, you know.
Two weeks later, I got a text from Ruth, quickly followed by a text from Rufus. Ruth was back into her hectic schedule like nothing ever happened. I managed to catch her for 5 minutes during her coffee break.
How's it feeling? What's it like being back?
Oh, it's great. Oh, I'm really enjoying being back with the patients. I love it.
How's the voice been?
It's been all right. The first day I was back, you started talking, and I could have sworn I was looking around. It just felt like everyone would know. But no one knew. No one looked. They just were getting on with what they were doing. So, I mean, that was like the first step to get past. And
well, he's not around as much now, is he?
Well, oh, I was sort of expecting this big change. You know, I thought once I go back, he's going to go, it's going to be it. But it hasn't happened, so it hasn't changed in that sense, you know.
Are you able to be competent as a doctor, do you think, hearing a voice?
Yeah, I am competent. And he's not going to make me incompetent. Him being there isn't a boundary. He's not the problem. It's if people find out, it's what they think, that would be the problem. So, yeah, I know, well, we're getting on. And the power balance has shifted.
What? You're more powerful now, is it?
I think I've probably got more power, yeah. I don't want to be disrespectful to him. We're in this together, so... Yeah. I've got to go. I've got to go back.
All right, sure. Okay. Great. Well, thanks.
That's all right.
Thanks for stopping by.
As always.
Yeah. See you soon.
For you, Leo, anything.
Thanks. Thank you, Ruth. Take care of yourself. Good luck. Anything else to say?
We could acknowledge the voice.
What do you mean?
Well, just say thanks to the voice.
Her voice?
Yeah.
How would you do that?
I'd just speak to it. If it wasn't for you, then I don't know if she'd be as emotionally strong and resourceful and resilient as she is. So I don't thank you for all the destructive ideas you've suggested to her, but in a way, in resisting you, in responding to your presence, she's become a very strong person, so maybe we should acknowledge that, say thanks.